The purpose of Jesus was a kingdom on earth in the hearts of men.
Rediscovering the kingdom will defy almost every concept you have about religion.
The message of Jesus was a message of a kingdom from heaven on earth. That was the message of Jesus.
Your thinking will be rearranged and your life empowered as Dr. Miles Monroe shifts the focus away from religion toward the ultimate issue, the kingdom of God.
Jesus came to restore these kings who lost their kingship and their kingdom.
Let us now join the seminar in progress.
This morning, about 2 hours ago, I was stuck in Detroit. I couldn't get back, and it was about 28 degrees, so you know I wanted to get back here. There was snow all over the place, so I said, get me back where God lives. I was speaking yesterday morning and Friday night at the Christian Business Network up there, headed by one of our trustees, Jerome Edmondson, and it's a wonderful seminar. There was about 1,000 business people up there, and it was a fantastic success. And I just got back this morning, a couple hours ago. Pastor Richard, I understand, did an awesome job this morning in our first service. God bless you. Preaching on the power of dominion of the kingdom of God. I'm going to pick up where he left off. And tonight, bring your Bible. Tell your neighbor it's going to be good tonight. Tell your neighbor the word of God is all you get. We're going to get into the word tonight. Matter of fact, we're going to have Pastor Gene sharing in our session tonight along with myself. And we're going to be teaching the word of God right from the root. So come prepared to go into the book that we've been studying, the book of Genesis, moving into the work. And I know God is going to continue to grow us up. Today, our topic is going to be very simple. And that is the kingdom mandate of Jesus' assignment. I want you to take notes this morning because I got a lot to cover in a short time. Our topic this morning is the kingdom mandate, which is the assignment of Jesus. What a topic to talk about. The assignment of Jesus. All those joining us by television, you are in the right place at the right time to hear the right message from the right God. That's Jehovah Jireh. We're so glad you're joining us here from the beautiful Bahama Islands. We welcome you all around the world watching our program today. And you are part of a series we're going through the Bible, studying especially in the book of Genesis, also the New Testament. We're studying the kingdom of God from the New Testament. And I'm starting this year off dealing with discovering your kingdom leadership. And we're going to get into this in more detail, but the session today is dealing with the assignment of Jesus, which is kingdom mandate. Everybody in the world was born to fulfill an assignment. In other words, every human was created by God to solve a problem. There's something that God wanted done that required your existence. So you are not a mistake. Can I hear an amen? Imagine that. God wanted something to fly, so he made birds. He wanted something to swim, so he made fish. There's something God wanted done, so he created you. So your place on this planet is related to an assignment that God had in his mind before anything was. And that makes you very critical to God's global and universal program. Today, we're going to talk about the assignment of somebody who is the creator of all things, and that is Jesus Christ. What was his assignment? And I do want to say that when we talk about the assignment of Jesus, we're really talking about the assignment of God. And when we look at the assignment of Jesus, it's very clear. First, we're going to understand what did God have in mind when he sent Jesus. I want to pick up reading a statement from the book of Matthew 24, a verse that we read last week, and then one from Matthew 4:17. The first verse I want you to take a note of, read it with me out loud, please. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached where? In all the world as a testimony to all nations, and then what would happen? Then the end would come. So the end of the world is predictable. A lot of people say, we don't know when the world will end. Well, Jesus tells us when. The only thing we don't know is the hour, the exact hour. But we do know what's going to make it happen. And it's found in that verse. He says, when this good news of the kingdom of God is preached to all the world, then the end will come. Matthew 4:17. Jesus began to preach. Matthew 4:17 is the beginning of his ministry on earth. The first statement of Jesus as a businessman is the declaration of his mission. Every effective company has to have a mission statement. Every effective organization must have a clear vision statement. Every successful family needs to have a clear objective in mind to be successful. And the first thing you present as an organization to be successful is you've got to define and crystallize your mission statement. This statement, Matthew 4:17, is the first public statement declared by Jesus concerning his mission on earth, his assignment. Let's read it together. Matthew 4:17, his first public statement. First word is what? Repent. So his first word has to do with your mentality. Repent means to change your mind, to change the way you think. Then his next statement is, because the kingdom of heaven has arrived. The King James says, is at hand. So Christ declares right away in his first statement what his business is about. He says, my business is twofold. Number one, I come to change your thinking. Why? Because I came to reintroduce a kingdom. That's my assignment. I came to bring back to the planet the kingdom of God, which is the kingdom of heaven, and I came to change your thinking so you can live in it. That was his assignment. That is why when they asked him about the end of the world, he said the end of the world will happen when the whole world gets my assignment. What's the assignment? In Matthew 24, he says, this gospel of the kingdom will be preached to every nation, every ethnos, every group. That's why Christ ain't going to come right now. A lot of people are preaching and prophesying that this is the end times. I got a problem with that. Because we got 6.2 billion people on earth. 1 billion is now in India. India just became over a billion people. And 98% of that 1 billion are Hindus, Buddhists, and Muslims. 10% are Christians. You know, God cannot come unless they hear about the kingdom of God. Then there's 1 billion in China. And 1% of the people in China, 1 billion, 1% are Christians. That means most of them are Buddhists, Shintoists, they are Muslims, or they are involved in some spiritism movement. They have never heard the gospel of the kingdom of God. In Africa alone, there are over 500 million people in just northern Africa, and another 800 million people down in southern Africa in those states. So you're talking about almost a billion people or more in the African continent, and many of them are animists. They evolve in all kinds of spiritist worship. But thank God Christianity has taken a stronghold in Africa. But many of them have still not heard the gospel of the kingdom of God. But here's the saddest news of all. In Europe and in the West, where we live, in the Americas and in the Caribbean and in Canada, there are over 80% Christians. But I dare challenge a thought that 90% of them have never heard the gospel of the kingdom of God. Many Christians have never heard the kingdom message. And that's why we're teaching this in this series. Much of what we've heard has been the means to the kingdom, but not the kingdom. We've heard about the way to the kingdom, but not the kingdom. As a matter of fact, we have made the process the gospel. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And this is why most Christians don't know about the kingdom of God. I am here to tell you that Jesus never preached born again as the gospel. Jesus mentioned the term born again once in his whole ministry. And we preach it all the time. He never preached it. Secondly, he never said those words to the public. He never said, thou shalt be born again to the multitudes. He never did. He mentioned it only once in his ministry, and it was mentioned 2 a.m. in the morning to an old man who was also a priest in the temple at 2 a.m., just to one person. And yet we've made born again the gospel. But there's one thing that Jesus did speak all the time, and we find it in his first statement in Matthew 4, wasn't it? What does he say? Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has arrived. And from that point forward, he had only one message. The kingdom of God is like, the kingdom of God is like, the kingdom of God is like, the kingdom of God. I mean, every single day, he just had one message. The kingdom of God is like. Every parable, the kingdom of God is like. Every miracle, the kingdom has come upon you. Every authority, the kingdom of God speaks. He preached one message, the kingdom of God. And yet, most of us don't know what he's talking about. And that's why we've got to study his assignment, because his assignment is your assignment. He left us to complete the work that he started in the ministry. He turned it over to his disciples, which is what you're supposed to be, and he told them exactly what to preach and what to teach and what to share. And there's no doubt about it. One more thing I want to say before we get into the next statement, and that is this. Jesus really never preached prosperity, healing, baptism in the Holy Ghost. The things that we preach as the kingdom, no, he didn't. He did those things. He showed those things, but they were not his message. His message was this kingdom thing. Why? Because the kingdom is the entire motivation of God. Why did Jesus come to preach the kingdom of God? First of all, it has to do with God's original plan. First of all, God's original plan begins this way. God's intent was to extend his heavenly kingdom on earth through mankind. That's his first intent. So in order to find out God's destination, you've got to discover where God's been. The Bible is a strange book, because the Bible is really a book that takes you backward to where you came from. God is taking us back to where we fell from. We call the disobedience of Adam, we call it the fall. So what I'm going to do is show you what fall means, because it was so simple to me years ago, I missed it. Here's what fall means. Look at me. I'm holding in my hand a book. I'm going to place this book in a certain position. That's why I want the book. That's my original place for the book. Well, the book has a problem and the book falls. So that's called the fall. Now, if I'm going to restore this book to where it fell from, what am I going to do? I'm going to put it where? Okay? So, this is what God did. The book couldn't get itself back up. So God had to come down, pick the book back up, and he personally places it back where it fell from. Now, if I were to pick this book back up and place it over here, did I restore it? No. Why? Because I placed it where it did not fall from. So restoration means to store back to the original place. What we have been doing as religious people, not me but y'all, is we've been trying to tell God to put us somewhere we didn't fall from and not where we fell from. We keep telling God to put us in heaven. We didn't fall from heaven. We fell from authority in the earth. Satan fell from heaven. not man. So heaven is not God's goal for you. And this is why religion has been such a challenge to God. Because his difficulty is getting his own family to get the message. We sing songs like, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away, in when I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. And that song sounds so good. And while we're singing that, we're thinking about mortgage, phone bill, light bill, water bill, tuition fees. We're getting away from that stuff. That's why we like that song. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. We love those songs. But those songs are not God's goal for you. God's goal is to get you back where you fell from. Where'd you fall from? According to the word of God, you fell from where God placed you. Where did God place you? He placed you in the book of Genesis in dominion over the fish, the birds, the plants, the cattle, and all the earth. That's where God placed you. You were established by God to be the king dominion over the earth. So restoration is God putting you back in dominion over the earth. So the program of God is really originally to extend his kingdom on earth, and secondly, to establish a family of sons, not servants, who would establish the kingdom on earth for him as sons and not subjects. Also, God wants to establish, therefore, a commonwealth of citizens, not Christians. God desired, therefore, relationship and not religion. And that's important to note because, you see, we have made what God wants into a religion, and God really hates this stuff. God doesn't want religion. He wants relationship. God wants you to be closer to him on Monday than you are on Sunday. Because the rituals impress people, but the relationship impresses God. God's more concerned there about a daily communion with him between you and he spiritually than he is about you standing up in a worship service singing hymns. Because that's really a demonstration of these traditions that we go through. But many times we have no relationship with God. That's why in the Garden of Eden, with Adam, there was no church meetings, no prayer meetings, no altars, no sacrifices, no worship songs. There was no clapping. There was no dancing. There was no hymn books. There were no prophets and apostles and evangelists and pastors and teachers. There was none of this stuff we call religion. And yet there was what? Man and God. And man was doing what? He walked and talked with God, the Bible says, in the cool of the day without having to go through a workup through a worship team. That's what you fell from. Now, if God's going to restore us, he has to be what? Truthful to himself. If God restores you to something you didn't fall from, then God is lying. And the Bible said, let God be true and every man a liar. Which means God's ultimate program is to put you back in leadership authority over the earth. And he wants us to do that now. Now, a lot of people say, well, we'll become in authority in the future, in the new earth. We'll, you know, when we all get to heaven and then we all come back, then we'll rule the earth. And that's when God, so we'll just kind of suffer right now and be poor and catch trouble. And then when Christ takes us out of this mess through the rapture, then we'll come back and then we can have our chance and we can really be in charge. That's not religious people think. Read the statement of Jesus in Matthew chapter 4, verse 17. He says, look, repent. Why? He didn't say the kingdom of God will come later. He said the kingdom of God has arrived. The disciple says, but we know in the future. He said, no. The kingdom of God is already with you. And when I release the Holy Ghost, he's going to be in you. The kingdom of God is not, it's not really a physical territory. The kingdom of God is a jurisdiction over which the influence of God have full authority. The kingdom of God is actually in my neighborhood right now, where my house is. Why? Because I live there. That piece of property that I own is the kingdom of God's property. Oh, help me, Lord. Wherever you are and you influence, the kingdom of God has come to that place. Let me break it down a little bit. The Bible never calls you a Christian. Pagans did that. The Bible never calls you a subject. The heathens do that. The Bible never calls you a servant. Religion calls you that. The Bible says, as many as believed on him, to them gave he the authority to call themselves what? Sons of God, not servants. We're family to God. Now, the Bible also calls you, write this word down please, ambassador. Everybody say ambassador. The Bible does call you that. You are ambassador. We named this building properly. A lot of people don't understand why I named this building the Diplomat Center. It's because I understand what we're here for. Ambassadors work in diplomatic centers. They do diplomacy for the government they represent. So when you walk through this door, you ain't a Christian no more. You are suddenly an appointee of the government, an official agency representing the kingdom government of God. You are now sitting in the legislative session of this particular gathering of diplomats, and I am the Chief Secretary of State, and I'm delivering to you from the Constitution the mind of my government so you can know what to do when you go out of here. I know exactly my position, and I know what I'm doing. Everybody say ambassador. Say it again. Repeat after me. I'm no longer a Christian. I'm an ambassador of Christ. See, if you think correctly, you live correctly. Let me tell you something about ambassadors. When a country appoints an ambassador and sends them into a foreign territory to represent their government, do you know what that country does first? The first thing that the country does who appoints the ambassador is that they purchase property in that country. Now, the property they purchase is actually the country. I'm going to say this slowly because some of you don't understand diplomacy. When a country buys property in another country for its embassy so that its diplomats can do its work, that property in that country becomes the country that bought it. It becomes the country. That is why if a Bahamian has a problem and somehow the law is after them, and they somehow got into the United States Embassy's property, do you realize that the police cannot cross that barrier? See, you didn't know that. It's illegal for them to enter that property. Why? That's the United States. They must now apply to the U.S. government, whose jurisdiction that is, and request that the government of the United States released that Bahamian out of the property so he could be arrested. You see, you didn't know that. That's how powerful an embassy is. Because the kingdom of that country is over the property it owns. It's called asylum. Are you listening to me? So, wherever the authority of a government is, that becomes the government's property. And therefore, all the authority and rights and powers of that country comes to effect on that property. God says, you are ambassadors of Christ in heaven, and you are what? You are sojourners in the earth. Sojourners means you are in a foreign country, but the property belongs to the government of heaven. I like what the government of my country says. My government says, now here's the Constitution. The Constitution says, in article, well, it's section Psalm, subsection 68, article 14. It says, the earth is still the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, and all that, in other words, this whole place is my government's property. In other words, if you don't take charge, then it stays under someone else's influence. That is why you can cast the devil out of the earth, because this is not his legal territory. It belongs to God's government, and you are his citizens. Do you realize that when you bought a car, your car became government property? Hey, Lord, I feel good. When you got your house or your apartment, every time you pay your rent, you are confirming that this piece of property belongs to the government of God. But you see, we think religious. That's why the devil lives in our house. Hallelujah. God told you in a vision, he said, look, I tell you all what. The death angel is going to come over Egypt. And the death angel is going to kill everything. So tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to make your house heaven's property. That's kingdom business he's dealing with. He said, look, there's somehow I've got to put a sign over your property so the angel will know that's we own. You get it? So God said, I want you to kill a lamb and dip the branch in the blood and put the blood across the lintel and the doorpost. He says, and when the dead angel comes, he'll look and he'll go heaven's property and he'll pass over. When you are a citizen, you are under government jurisdiction. When you are a Christian, you are under religion. You know, I was living in a hotel last night before I got here, and they put me on the 11th floor. It was a request. But they were going to put me on the 14th floor. And I said, no, ma'am, I do not live above the 11th floor. She said, why? I said, I'm a diplomat. She said, oh, okay, I understand. Sorry, sir. And she put me on the 11th floor. Some of you are trying to figure out what I mean, eh? No government leader and no diplomat of any country will live above the 12th floor. Do you know why? Because the fire engine ladder cannot go above the 13th floor. See, y'all like, y'all behemoths, y'all like be high. First one to heaven when the fire comes. Just learn some of the diplomacy, eh? As a part of the diplomatic corps in my country, we had to have briefing. They had to brief me. And they told me certain things that I must not do. And that was one of them. Secondly, you will never have the two top leaders traveling together in diplomacy. Because when two leaders are together, there's a danger to the whole country. Because if both die, there's chaos. So the prime minister and the deputy will never fly on the same flight. You didn't notice that. President Bush and Dick Cheney will never travel together on the same airplane. It goes against diplomacy. That's why when two powerful men and women of God get together, they ain't supposed to fly together. You see, because all the hell get excited, two at one stroke. Come on, talk to me. Devil ain't no fool. Where there's a congregation of power, that's when Satan gets excited, because he gets to destroy a lot at once. That's why Christ told the disciples, meet me on the other side. You go by yourself. Why? Because you all been with me now for 3 years. You all are dangerous. See, you understand? Kingdom thinking. When an ambassador comes into your presence, it's not a person anymore. It's a country. Hallelujah. When you meet an ambassador, you're not meeting a person. You're meeting a country. So when you meet me, you're not meeting a person anymore. You're meeting heaven. And when they meet you at your work tomorrow, they're not supposed to be meeting a person. But you see, you're too religious. You still thinking you're just a sinner saved by grace. No, you are a nation walking on two legs. That's why an ambassador is protected more than the president. They would assassinate a president before they kill an ambassador. Did you know that? That's right. Because the president represents the votes, but the ambassador represents the nation. That's why God calls you an ambassador, not a president. If you touch an ambassador, the entire army comes to get you. If you touch a president, it's called an assault. If you touch an ambassador, it is called an international incident.